Shalom, this is Rabbi David Eidensohn, author of the book Secret of the Scale. The secret of the scale is how to love yourself, appreciate yourself, and find value in yourself as someone created by Hashem, by God. Today we are talking about Jewish leadership. We turn to a passage in Yechezkel and the prophet Ezekiel. And the prophet tells the Jews their tragedy is because of leadership. They had their own leaders. There were people that worked in the temple, Kohanim, priests, who were not worthy, who were not sincere, who used their position to make money. There were priests and leaders and prophets who were false, who taught people to worship idols. And this destroyed the Jewish people. And despite the fact that the Jews were led astray, and ultimately the temple was destroyed and the Jews were exiled, the prophet tells us that there is a remnant of good people, a remnant of good prophets, a remnant of good priests. And he says, those who have defiled their leadership positions, those who have brought contempt upon the priesthood with their deeds, they will not serve me. But the Kohanim HaLevim B'nei Tzodok, those from the family of Tzodok, who are righteous people, Asher Shomer Esh Mismeres Midoshi, that they held on firm to the Torah. Pehases B'nei Someolai, even at a time when the majority of Jews strayed away, they were not interested in listening to the true prophets and to the true priests. They, the family of Tzolot, the few priests that were sincere and devoted, and they kept to the Torah, they will serve, he says Hashem. And they will come to serve me in the temple. Nothing is more crucial in Jewish history than Jewish leadership. When there is the proper leadership, the Jews do well. And when there is not the proper leadership, Jews collapse. The great Talmudist, Rabbi Elazar HaGadol, Rabbi Elazar the Great, was dying. Rabbi Akiva, his prime disciple, was crying. And Rabbi Elazar the Great says to Rabbi Akiva, Akiva, why are you crying? He says, Rebbe, in just a few moments, you can teach me the greatest secrets of the Torah. You answer all my questions. Now what will I do? Where will I learn Torah? That is why I am crying, said Rabbi Akiva. Rabbi Elazar the Great said to Rabbi Akiva, no, do not say, I am crying because I can't ask questions in Torah from anyone. That is not why you should cry. You should cry because when the Jews don't have the proper leadership, when the Jews don't have a Rabbi Elazar the Great to look at, they will look up to other people. The brazen ones, the asesponim ones, and that will be their ruination. Throughout Jewish history, those people who attached themselves to the proper Jewish leadership, they survived, and the other ones did not. And throughout Jewish history, there were always people who had a different idea than the Torah. Even in the time of Moses and Moshe, there were Jews who felt, look, let's go back to Egypt. What do we need this for? Let's worship the golden calf. There was the congregation of Korach that rebelled against Moshe. There were the spies who turned the Jews against the idea of going to Israel. There were always problems because there were always problems of leadership. And even in the time of Moshe, of Moses, of the 12 senior heads of the tribes, there were two faithful ones and 10 had failed and said, God cannot bring us to Israel. We will not merit God's protection, so we'll be killed and destroyed. People who didn't have the faith that Hashem would help them to bring them to Israel. Years ago, after the Second World War, when the Holocaust deprived the Jewish people of true Torah leadership, there were very few Torah rabbis left in the world. But by great miracle, there was a train of rabbis who went through Russia in the middle of the war and came to Japan, to Shanghai, and they stayed through the war. And they came to America, to Israel, and they rebuilt Torah. My teachers, when I went to yeshiva in the 50s, were these Holocaust survivors that were on that train. The brothers, Nechemya Malin, sons of the dying and brisk, came to Washington, D.C. They made a yeshiva there, or Torah de Brisk. I studied there. And then, a couple of years later, when I was 15, I went out of town to Baltimore, to Yeshiva Chofetz Chaim. And there, the Rebbes also were people that came from the European destruction and escape. And then I went to Lakewood to learn by Rabban Kotler Zatzal. Rabban was on this train. And as the train was going through Russia, a communist came on board and said, "What is this, a train of rabbis in communist Russia? This is not going to happen." And Rabban went over to him, argued with him, whatever, and the train kept going. Great miracles happened. Great miracles happened. And the Jews on the train were saved. And they provided the Torah leadership for the next generation. Such a miracle. But the Torah lives with miracles. And those of us, a few of us, who merited to see a Ramalin, a Rabowski, a Rabban Kotler, those of us who merited this, we have leadership. We saw great Gedolim, we saw great people. People completely honest and dedicated to Hashem and the Torah. And that sustained us and gave us courage, despite the fact that when I went outside in the street with the yarmulke, people would yell, "What's the matter with you? You're religious? You don't believe that you came from monkeys?" Oh, it's unacceptable. That's the way it was then. But those that had Torah leadership could hang on, and the Torah survived with these few prophets, these few teachers. Of course, today we don't have prophets, but we have great Torah leaders, Gedolim, such as Rabban, such as Ramesh, such as Rabbi Yankiv. And Baruch Hashem, I merited in my time to see these great Gedolim, Rabbi Yaakov Kamenetsky, and Moshe Feinstein, and Rabban Kotler, many great Gedolim, and they infused in a new generation the spirit of Torah so that the impossible happened, that Torah survived. But in each generation, there are prophets and there are false prophets. There was a great argument between the religious rabbis, the Gedolim, and the secular leadership of how the Jews should be. And the whole issue of Israel was great debates. And all of these debates are now being resolved. Everyone recognizes that there are no secular solutions. There are no more beliefs and idols. Nobody believes anymore in the old promises. There was a time the Jews believed in communism. Nobody believes in communism today. There was a time the Jews believed in secularism. There were Jews who believed that the world would somehow accept Jews and become more civilized. Well, they saw how civilized the civilized Germany became. And all the old dreams of secular people, that things are going to change by secular means, nobody believes these things anymore.